Welcome back. The water dispute between India and Pakistan. Deadlock persisted during the two-day Pakistan-India water dialogue in which the delegations of both sides maintained their original stance. The head of the Indian delegation, Pradeep Kumar Saxena, reviewed Pakistan's objections on the two Chenab River hydro projects that are the 1,000 megawatts Pakal Dul and the 48 megawatts Lower Kalnai. But the Indian delegation also presented its point of view in response to the objections and made it clear that India will continue to work on both hydropower projects. Similarly, India believes that the projects are in line with the Indus Water Treaty and requires no amendments as demanded by Pakistan. The Pakistani delegation, on the other hand, asked the Indians to reduce the height of the Pakal Dul's reservoir up to 5 meters. Other than this, Pakistan has also demanded more transparency into the spillover gateway mechanisms of the hydropower dams and their timing of the release as well. Pakistan also raised some technical concerns over the design of the Lower Kalnai Dam. Pakistan Water Commissioner has been raising objections over these two Chenab River projects since a very long time and has demanded that India to halt the construction on the sites until India could give a satisfactory answer to Pakistan. Pakistani Commissioner for Indus Waters, Syed Meher Ali Shah, has not made the details of the discussion public due to the sensitivity of the topic, but according to some sources, India has agreed to the inspection of its hydropower sites by Pakistani experts due to end by the next month. Some sources state that the reasons behind Pakistan's failure to persuade India have been due to internal team conflicts and the lack of preparation before going into the meeting. It is also said that the senior officials of Indus Water Commissioner Shiraz Maimon and Usman Ghani were sidelined by the commissioner Syed Meher Ali Shah, who preferred team members from the National Engineering Services of Pakistan instead. Pakistan has already expressed that if the issues are not resolved through bilateral water dialogue, then it will have no choice but to go to the International Court of Arbitration in the future. Recently, the Supreme Court formed an implementation committee on the Amir Basha and Momand dams, which recently submitted its report on the logistics and other encompassing issues related to the construction of the dams, whose initiative was undertaken by none other than Chief Justice of Pakistan, Mia Saqib Nisar. As of now, the total collection of the Amir Fund was recorded at more than 1.58 billion rupees. This is a very small percentage of the total cost of both dams, which is calculated to be around 1,750 billion rupees, aside from the maintenance and operating costs. According to the experts, due to the lack of dams and reservoirs, Pakistan wastes around $40 billion worth of sweet water every year. That's a big number. And right now, the country has a water storage capacity of just 20 to 25 days, as compared to India, which has a water storage capacity of nearly 130 days. Well, to further discuss the recent Pakistan-India water dialogue and the looming water crisis, we are now joined by Ali Tauqeer Sheikh, senior water expert and CEO of LEED Pakistan, an environmental think tank. Sir, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So firstly, tell us, why do you think that the details of the water dialogue haven't been made public by Pakistan's Commissioner for Indus Water, Syed Meher Ali Shah? Shouldn't the people of Pakistan have a right to know about these important matters?
I think, sir, there's a long-standing tradition because of interruptions in democracy that the democratic and the citizens' information, democratic oversight and citizens' information on this has historically and traditionally been extremely limited and somewhat distorted. Your point, I think, is very important that there is a parliamentary committee for oversight. There is a ministry, and the department is supposed to highlight what the issues are at stake and the position, the government's position, if not the negotiating position, but at least what the stakes are and what the adversary is planning to do, should have been debated in public domain, in media, electronic and print media, as well as with think tanks and research institutions. The greater the discourse and debate we have in the society, better prepared we will be in future.
Sir, but what reasons do you think that the water person will have for not disclosing such important matters, that too with India, and considering that Pakistan is the country with a big water problem right now?
Traditionally, as I mentioned earlier, we have seldom disclose our position and the stakes as far as Indus Water Treaty are concerned. We have considered as a security subject, and for all practical purposes, most the media and citizens and think tanks, even the parliamentary leaders have been kept out of the loop on such issues. The issues that you mentioned are very important, and of course you are spot on in saying, in starting the program with emphasizing and underlining that the debate and discourse need to be broadened so that we don't keep going in circles. Now, if I have a moment, I can explain to you what I'm trying to say.
Please, sir.
Pakistan has very legitimate and concrete concerns. Our interests are tangible. But regrettably, we do not have negotiation position. We don't know what the bottom line is. We don't know what we want from the enemy. And we don't know what we are willing to give to them. And we have adopted a maximalist policy that the winner takes it all. We want India to accept all our demands. And in return, they reject all our expectations and demands. So it has become a zero-sum proposition. These are not the negotiations. These are just the procedural grounds of Indus Water Commission that have been holding for many years now without making an iota of progress, because we are not protecting our interests. We are just protecting our position. And positions that are not disclosed in public, and therefore we don't know what the bottom line is, what is that we want to, as a minimum, want to get from the adversary or from the other side.
So in your expert opinion, tell us, as a Pakistani, I want to know, and the viewers want to know, who is benefiting from all these water dialogues? Clearly, Pakistan has a water capacity of reservoirs of only 20 days, whereas India has the water reservoir capacity of nearly 130 days. Besides, India has made numerous dams in the past couple of years, whereas Pakistan is still deliberating upon whether to build the dam or not. Your comments, sir.
Pakistan has plenty of water. As most of this water comes during monsoon, we do need to have system for inter-season water supply. Having said that, Pakistan's per capita water availability is greater than what they have in India or what they have in Afghanistan or what they have in China or what they have in Afghanistan. Pakistan's per capita water is more than any of its neighbors. Having said that, I want to engage with India on equal footing in terms of benefit sharing. I just gave you an example that in 5 meters of additional height that I don't like in India to construct, I want my share of water there that I want to get at the time that I need. And there are similarly other propositions that they can see. The point is that Western rivers are ours, but as low riparians, they cannot stop India from constructing. Legally or illegally, they can contribute. Now, somehow I have to stop them, and the best way to stop them is through negotiating a benefit sharing formula and not having a zero-sum game whereby each victory by them or each victory by us is seen as a loss by the other.
Right. Sir, do you believe that the Diamir, Basha and Momun dams can be built through public funding alone? And why hasn't Pakistan required assistance from development banks in this regard?
Well, these dams can be constructed, but not by encouraging poor people to give 10 rupees each. I think they can be constructed by introducing agricultural tax. I think money can be collected through water tax, just the way we pay electricity and sewage gas. We need to pay for water as well, in agriculture in particular. And I think present government of Imran Khan gives us a very good opportunity to introduce water pricing and water taxation in the provincial assembly. And the federal government needs to provide a leadership, firm leadership on this. That's a formula for us to get a long-term revenue base to construct reservoirs if we want to construct that. But having said that, the poor man's 10 rupees will not give us the dams that we need at the cost that it has. Remember, these dams will take many, many years. But at the same time, we know it very well that Pakistan wastes more than half of its water in the system. So no matter how many dams we construct, we'll not solve our problem unless we bring water efficiency. And the only way to bring water efficiency is through water pricing. These days when we had water scarcity, the Tarbela Dam, which is the world's largest surface dam, was empty. what guarantee that I have that the new reservoirs will not be empty as well? As much as I need them, and I'll need to construct some of them, it's very important for us to look at other sources of managing our water, such as the groundwater, which meets almost 60% of agriculture needs in the country. And that's a strategic reserve that's depleting very, very rapidly. And coming a few decades, we will have a challenge that we'll not have sufficient water for the water-thirsty crops that Pakistan in its agriculture is producing.
So, what do you think lacks from Pakistan's current water policy? Surely something seems to be wrong, since the water storage capacity of the whole country is just 20 days. And as you mentioned, the Rabela is empty. We have the world's biggest earth fill dam and it's empty. Why isn't the government building smaller reservoirs? Or managing water? I have a list of the pie chart in front of me. It says that the consumption pattern of water in Pakistan, the agriculture sector takes 69% of our water, industry 23%, and domestic use a mere 8%. So tell us, how do we conserve or improve our water policy in Pakistan?
Sir, you have raised two questions. One is, what's missing? I think leadership and vision is missing. It's an orphan subject. We had Ministry of Power and Water for many, many years, and they focused only on power and water was ignored. Now we have Ministry for Water and Resources. Even the new cabinet does not have a Minister for Water. The new parliament will need to have a water committee as quickly as we can, and Senate will need to have a committee as soon as we can. In terms of vision, we can fuel our economy with water only if we can use it as strategically, by introducing efficiency and conservation, and that can only be done through water pricing. Now, if agriculture consumes 92% of our water, and I don't know where you got your...
Sir, 69%, sir.
My statistics is 92% goes to agriculture, but even if it's 69 or 70%, we cannot provide our A-class water for C-class agriculture. We are growing water-thirsty crops in deserts. We are growing sugar cane and rice, and we export. And globally, I think we are subsidizing the middle classes in Europe. Whenever they buy cotton products of Pakistan, we are essentially taking taxpayers' money that we do not charge, because it's free, it's subsidized. And some studies suggest that in our trade with Europe, we are subsidizing about $4 billion worth of water to European trade only. So therefore, a starting point for us is to revisit our agricultural practices that consume so much water. Domestic water percentage is very small, but we are ruthlessly careless, and we don't try to conserve water, even if it's smaller percentage, 4 or 6%. And industry per unit, per drop, production has to be improved. I just want to give you an example of Israel. Israel's GDP is almost 3 times Pakistan. And water supply, per capita water supply, they have is roughly 1% of Pakistan's total water. So if we bring water efficiency in our economy, Pakistan's economy can achieve much faster growth rate. We can create more jobs by having water conservation and water saving. We can have better yield in many, many instances. And we can give better livelihood options to people in areas where the water is in limited quantities.
Mr. Sheikh, it was a pleasure to have you on the show, and it was a very enlightening interview. And I do hope that the incoming government does take up your suggestions. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Well, now it's time for a short break. See you at the other side of the break.